Good morning, brothers and sisters. We're so glad that you've joined us this morning here at Community of Joy. And we just want to gather today to embrace the love of Jesus Christ that is within us. And we just want to praise his holy name today. So we're glad you're joining us, whether you're here with us or online. So let's make a joyful noise and praise the Lord Jesus Christ.
Bones, you're about to move. I feel it in the wind, you're about to ride in. You say you would pour your spirit out. You say you would fall on sons and daughters. So let the rain come drench us in love. Your glory rushing like a flood. We are fixed on this one thing, to know your goodness and see your glory. We're transformed by this one thing, to know your presence and see your beauty. Now your kingdom come. I can hear it now in the sound of heaven. You said if we ask, we'll receive. So we're asking for the greater measure. So let the rain come drench us in love. Like a flood, we are fixed on this one thing, to know your goodness and see your glory. We're transformed by this one thing, to know your presence and see your
blow on through.
We'd like to welcome with us this morning Suzi Peterson joining us this morning, and she's going to be sharing our message, but first she's going to read us some scripture.
Thanks. Morning, everyone.
Morning.
So from Matthew 25, verses 31 through 46, I'm reading this morning. Now when the human one comes in his majesty, and all his angels are with him, he will sit on his majestic throne. All the nations will be gathered in front of him. He will separate them from each other, just as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right side, but the goats he will put on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who will receive good things from my Father, inherit the kingdom that was prepared for you before the world began. I was hungry, and you gave me food to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothes to wear. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then those who are righteous will reply to him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you a drink? When did we see you as a stranger and welcome you, or naked and give you clothes to wear? When did we see you sick or in prison and visit you?" Then the king will reply to them, "I assure you that when you have done it for the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you have done it for me." Then he will say to those on his left, "Get away from me, you who will receive terrible things. Go into the unending fire that has been prepared for the devil and his angels. I was hungry, and you didn't give me food to eat. I was thirsty, and you didn't give me anything to drink. I was a stranger, and you didn't welcome me. I was naked, and you didn't give me clothes to wear. I was sick and in prison, and you didn't visit me." Then they will reply, "Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and didn't do anything to help you?" Then he will answer you, "I assure you that when you haven't done it for the least of these, you haven't done it for me." And they will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous ones will go into eternal life.
Past the point of weary, is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Did you feel that empty feeling? 'Cause shame's done all its stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh, he makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, amen, amen. Who can wipe away the tears from broken dreams and wasted years? Tell the past to disappear. Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus. All the wrong turns that you would go and undo if you could. Who can work it all for your good? Say about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sin that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Let my Jesus change your life.
Good. All right. Join me in prayer this morning before we start. Our souls are poured out before you, O God, as we look for more in life than contentment with family, friends, and possessions. We thank you, dear Lord, for all of your blessings. Yet in our souls, we long to be a blessing to others on your behalf. As Abraham was a blessing to many nations, as Hannah longed for something in her life to offer back to God, we long to make a difference in this world for you. Open our eyes, good Lord, to whatever you have already entrusted for the good of your people. Open our ears, Lord, to intersections between human need and heart's desire. Open our hearts, Lord, to recognize and nurture new gifts, to consider unique possibilities dawning on the horizon. Our souls are poured out before you, O God. Let your servants find favor in your sight. Amen. Okay, so here's the deal. Martin asked me months and months ago to preach, and because I knew I'd be sharing the sermon with the people of TRP tonight as well, I plan to use scripture from the lectionary, which is what we've been doing. So for the weeks, I've had the words of Mark 13, 1 through 13, rustling around in my head, ruminating on the ancient Near Eastern context of the passage, as well as how I could link it to our lives today, some kind of practical, meaningful way. And then life happened, as it does. Unexpected, life-changing, and even devastating. I'm going to try to get through this without losing it. You see, I started Monday off attending the viewing of a friend's brother who had died from an overdose. I got home, sat down, watched a show or the news, I really can't remember, and I got a shocking phone call less than 30 minutes in. The call was from an individual letting us know that our very good friend had taken his life just hours before. My husband and I, we experienced an overwhelming wave of shock, grief, and sadness all at once. Once we processed what we had just learned, our thoughts immediately shifted to our dear friend who had been suddenly forced into the role of widow and their amazing kids. We left our house and headed directly to their home, the home where we had spent so many days and nights when our kids were younger, the home that's always been filled with happy memories of our two families being with each other. The memories and stories our family of five could share could fill up some time. Here's the thing I'm learning about pastoring. Sometimes the things that you're experiencing in your own life must steer how you pastor and care for others. I could get up here and preach on Mark 13, most likely rather half-heartedly, but instead I'm going to go with what's in my heart this morning. I'm choosing to scrap the plan. I'm letting go of the text about grand temples and the disciples' obliviousness to what Jesus was attempting to do. I'm letting go of the apocalyptic literature that paradoxically is not about the end of the world. If you want to hear more about that, we can meet over coffee sometime. But today I'm going to be vulnerable and speak from my heart. When a tragedy like this occurs, I know I at least begin to ask big questions of our God. Why? How could he let this happen? Why would he allow this pain? If he's a loving God, why do people suffer so? Does he care? And will we ever know the answers? We hear a variety of well-meaning platitudes to try to explain God's role in it all. Everything happens for a reason, or it's all part of God's plan. You get the picture. But none of these satisfy. None of these make sense when we're trying to reconcile how a loving, gracious God can allow such pain, suffering, and grief. I think it's in our human nature that we just want to understand. So this is not going to be a satisfying answer for anyone here today or listening. But I know that I'm in a community right now that doesn't need answers beautifully packaged with a bow on top. So here's my best answer, at least for today. I don't think we need to know. Truth is, we're never going to have all of the answers in this lifetime. So for me, I would rather spend my time thinking of the ways that God shows up in situations like this. I stewed and stewed about what to say for this talk this week when I believe that God placed these words on my heart and mind during my Thursday morning routine, actually during my shower. Shower brings some good thoughts sometimes. And it was this: God shows us his love through his people. There's nothing groundbreaking about this sentiment, nothing you haven't heard 100 times or more before, but I do believe that it is important to be reminded of this every so often. What I have seen and experienced this week has been a beautiful reminder of God's love for us. My dear friend and her kids have been loved on and cared for in a way that renews your sense of humanity. Just as in Matthew 25, their every basic need has been provided to them. They've been fed, almost overwhelmingly so. I tend to enjoy reflecting on how our first response in tragedy is to provide sustenance for others. I think there's something really beautiful about that. Their home has been cared for, with every household chore being completed before ever even being anticipated. And as we've spent time there this week, their home has been filled with love. It's been filled with lots of stories about our dear friend, a man of God, with such a sweet spirit that loved practical jokes and making people laugh. It's been filled with laughter and with tears. Simply put, it's been a home that has been overflowing with God's love. It's easy to think about the gospel message as a means to get to heaven, especially when it's what you've probably heard your entire life. But I think we're selling Jesus' message short when we think only of the individual benefits to us. You know, Jesus died so we can go to heaven. At TRP, we talk all the time about the role of Jesus, the role that Jesus played and continues to play in bringing heaven to earth. I may be wrong, what do I know? But in the last 6 days, the response I've seen to this tragedy, to this premature death, has been nothing short of seeing heaven brought to earth. Why did it happen? I don't know. But for now, at least, I'm choosing to focus on the response of people. People I believe are following the gentle nudge of a loving God. I'm quite sure that if I sat down with each person here today, you could tell me stories of personal loss, tragedy, of sorrow. And I also bet that if we look hard enough, we can see instances of God's grace, His love, and His redemption through the actions of people. We all know that Jesus' disciples were ordinary, flawed people tasked with the mighty job of spreading the gospel message after Jesus was gone. There are plenty of stories in the Bible of how these men were used by God. I don't know about you, but that gives me some confidence to think that perhaps, too, I can be an instrument of God. In the earlier passage, verses 35 through 36 say, "For I was hungry, and you gave me food to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me." These acts of service are just some of the examples of the deeds of mercy that one can provide. Each one of them met a specific need in a specific situation. A kind word or the willingness to truly listen may be what someone in your life needs. Helping a friend move. I know, that's a tough one. That may be what they need. Checking in with someone or simply providing a safe place to be authentic may be just what is needed. Just as human needs are boundless, the possibilities to provide mercy are too. The kinds of mercies that Jesus rewards in this scripture are within the reach of every person. They do not require great sacrifice on the part of the giver, but they do alleviate great pain for the receiver. I really don't have a neat, packaged up closing to this, but I would like to invite you to participate in this contemplative exercise that we do at TRP quite a bit. So I'm going to read the scripture again, and then we'll go from there. "Now when the human one comes in his majesty and all his angels are with him, he will sit on his majestic throne. All the nations will be gathered in front of him. He will separate them from each other, just as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right side, but the goats he will put on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who will receive good things from my Father, inherit the kingdom that was prepared for you before the world began. I was hungry, and you gave me food to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothes to wear. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me.' Then those who are righteous will reply to him, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you a drink? When did we see you as a stranger and welcome you, or naked and give you clothes to wear? When did we see you sick or in prison and visit you?' Then the king will reply to them, 'I assure you that when you have done it for the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you have done it for me.' Then he will say to those on his left, 'Get away from me, you who will receive terrible things. Go into the unending fire that has been prepared for the devil and his angels. I was hungry, and you didn't give me food to eat. I was thirsty, and you didn't give me anything to drink. I was a stranger, and you didn't welcome me. I was naked, and you didn't give me clothes to wear. I was sick and in prison, and you didn't visit me.' Then they will reply, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and didn't do anything to help you?' Then he will answer, 'I assure you that when you haven't done it for one of the least of these, you haven't done it for me.' And they will go away into your eternal punishment, but the righteous ones will go into eternal life. So in response to this discussion, I invite you where you are to feel held right where you are, to know that you're safe, to know that you are loved. Let the tension out of your shoulders. Unclench your jaw. Let the weight you carry begin to slip off. When you find your place of comfortability and security, close your eyes and take a few deep breaths. Inhale, assurance. Exhale, self-doubt. Inhale, calm. Exhale, settledness, unsettledness. Inhale, hope. Exhale, defeat. In our passage this morning, the questions were posed, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you a drink? When did we see you as a stranger and welcome you, or naked and give you clothes to wear? When did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? I ask you to think about these questions. When did you provide the love of Jesus for others? About this. What is a tangible step that you can take to provide for the needs of others? Are there gentle reminders that God has given you, but it's been easier to ignore them than act on them? And finally, what is speaking to you this morning? You are loved. You are honored by the Most High God. Lord, Holy God, loving Father, you give us the task to love one another because you are holy and you have loved us before we could love you. Give us the ability to recognize your Son in our brothers and our sisters far and near. Make us witnesses that love exists and is alive, and that you, the God of love, exist and are alive now and forever. Amen. So I know that Pastor Martin does a talk back portion. And I know at TRP, after we do these little exercises, we open it up for any kind of sharing or any kind of epiphany that you may have had, or just any thoughts that you want to share. So I open up the floor to you this morning. Okay.
First question. What is TRP?
The Restoration Project.
Restoration.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. I kept on trying to guess that one.
Sorry. I should have put the whole thing out there.
just one comment. You know, good job on a hard subject, you know?
Thank you.
I mean, there is no great super answer to the whole thing. So I just want to say, you know, you took the tiger by the tail and taken that one on for yourself. So good job.
Thank you. Thanks.
Just to comment, what follows you were saying about personal tragedy, there's no one, you know, especially as we get older, that hasn't been through at least one devastating loss. And I for myself, and I won't go into the details, but out of that comes learning. It comes, it makes us better people on many times, and maybe more compassionate to those who went through the same thing. Because I remember coming home, leaving the hospital, just laying on the bed and saying, God, why us? And I got the answer, right? Why not you? Pick somebody else and I'll give it to them. So just, you know, then, but moving from that to just leading me to contemplate, you know, it opened up my spirituality more, and, you know, asking, you know, trying to understand the nature of things. And one thing I learned in Buddhism is when the conditions are right, things occur. And when they aren't, like when the trees are starting to bloom, and the flowers are blooming in the spring, and you get a late freeze, those blooms withdraw. The conditions aren't right. So, and that happens with us. Sometimes the conditions are no longer right for whatever event it is that we wish to be so.
Right.
And I remember saying, you know, I was explaining to my son, Carter, when he was five, why I wasn't married to my first wife. And we went through what happened, and Carter looks at me and he just says, with the five-year-old, you know, the lack of a filter and not, you know, don't have all these other prejudices, well, Daddy, maybe he just wasn't ready to be born.
Mm.
You know, and that just, it took me 10 years to, you know, to get to that point. And he just like summed it all up. And,
yeah.
And the result is that I have these two wonderful children. So out of hard times comes very good times.
Yes.
And real quick, we have spent a lot of time talking here about the wear and tear on healthcare workers and educators during COVID. And I think another group we really need is all of our pastors, our reverends, ministers, imams. They have really shouldered a burden.
This is really an unprecedented time of there's so much hurt and there's so much sadness.
And this too shall pass, and hopefully we will learn something from it. I don't know how long it'll stick, but maybe
let's
we'll learn
soon.
But if we could, as we go forward, just, you know, let's keep in mind our pastors, reverends, ministers, rabbis, imams, and all the other folk who, you know, listen to their various congregations in their times of need.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Online, Sheila Curtis has shared, what a beautiful message of God's love shown through his people towards others in need. She says, thank you, COJ, for the nice cards for Allie. Sorry, it moved on me. She hasn't read them just yet. However, your love and kindness is indicative of God's love. We love you all. And a praise report, Allie will be moving to a rehabilitation hospital tomorrow. Please keep us in prayer. And Tammy Brown has shared a beautiful message that I really need to hear. The recent death of our nephew has us, our family, with lots of why. But what I heard today is a reminder of how loved on my sister and brother-in-law, niece, and her husband were during this time. All of us were. We were shown an overflowing of God's love through family and friends. Thank you for your words.
So this was very timely. You know, I think it was an important message a lot of people needed to hear this morning. I've had really angry questions for God for a really, really long time. Longer than I think I've even considered. And some of those questions that are still roiling around, it's going to be a long time before I can get past them, are, you know, why'd you even put Satan in the tree? Why did you give him permission to be there? Because he wasn't there by accident. He couldn't have snuck past you. He couldn't have beat you up. You know, you're God. You let him there. What's up with that? And that's where it all starts, you know, all the other angry questions. And so I've been going to counseling for a long time and talking about that. One of those, that particular question, and a lot of other things. But when I started with the counseling, Aaron was little. And there was one particular session where I was beating on this question a lot. And Aaron was toddling around the room, and there were lifesavers in a bowl, you know, the great big ones, the minty ones, in a bowl, which he liked at the time. And he brought it over to me and, of course, was waving it in my face. So I unwrapped it, and I'm holding on to it, and I'm letting him suck on it. And he's getting mad at me because I'm not giving him the whole thing, right? And he wants the whole thing, and he keeps trying to get it out of my hand and fussing at me. And I'm sitting there going, no, baby, no, I've got to hold it. It's too big. You're going to choke on it. It's too much. And he, of course, he's one or two or however old he was at the time and doesn't understand that. And I keep telling him, honey, you'll choke. You'll choke. And then, of course, like, well, it hit me like a brick that this was an object lesson. You know, he's, I've got to hold it. I can't give you the whole thing. You'll choke. You have to trust me and let me hold it. And so that's been the struggle, is learning to trust again. But the only answer that I've been able to make for myself, and I have to hold on to it, is that maybe, just maybe, for this whole thing to work and to exist, was that grace had to exist. And the only way for grace to be born and exist was for the fall to happen first, so that Christ could come and be Emmanuel. And for salvation to happen because of it. And so, you know, it was all part of the plan. And we just have to trust that the rest of it's going to come to fruition, and it's time. You know, God knows what he's doing, and he's holding it, so I won't choke.
Thank you.
Holly, I have one thing. Over here, myself. One thing that I have learned, because just all of us have had tragedies that in our lives that make no sense to us whatsoever. Why would God this? Why? And the problem is that we're trying to figure out God. And our little
pea brains,
human minds. Yeah. But one thing I have learned is this. The more tumultuous the ocean waves and the storm at the top on the water, trying to hold on to the boat, and some people falling out and drowning, whatever, God is calling us to sink to the depths of our being to find him there. He's trying to force us away from the turmoil. And sometimes it's a big thing that moves us to look deeply inside where love is. Our desire to share love and, the tragedies, when our hearts are broken, that's how you gain empathy and compassion. That's when you reach out to serve and love. God moves us to do what we need to do, and we don't understand who, what, where, or when, or how, but it is. And that is called faith, but we have hope. And that hope is so important because we have, over so many thousands of years, gotten the message wrong. The truth of the message is love. There is only one big message in God's word, and it is love. No matter what your hurt, what your pain, we are to love, because then we are being who we truly are. And all the agony and doubts and anger in our minds, you got to set that aside and to go to that place of stillness where he is. Otherwise, you keep questioning. And it's not something that we can do, but we want to. We're just a big mess. We are. We're all just a big mess. But look deep down inside of yourself, because that's where that true love is. That can take away all that pain, because the pain can be unbearable without Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
Final hug.
Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Upon you, be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. In a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and the children, and the children, may his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, He is with you in the morning, in the evening, and you're coming and you're going, and you're weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, 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 He is for you. Amen, 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 amen,
place on this day, remember that our Lord Jesus Christ is for you, not against you. Everything that we experience in life every day is actually Him drawing us nearer to Him if we choose to see it in His way and not ours. Go this week and remember, lavish His love upon the world, everyone around you and near you, and also to love that which is within yourself, which is Jesus Christ Himself. Go with peace. Amen.